Today I would like to welcome Ms. Gopika Kapoor on our channel. So her formal introduction would be that she has a formal degree in journalism and she has written other books than Beyond the Blue. As many of you would know that she has been an autism therapist for 10 years and she has led and coordinated training programs across countries to train on autism therapy. So she is also good. She is also known to be a good storyteller. And the occasion on which we are meeting her today is this book, which is called as Beyond the Blue, and it is beautifully written. So I would really like to welcome you again on our channel, and it's our pleasure to have you today.
Thank you so much, Sonal.
Yeah. So apart from this introduction, I would like to say that I have been trained by you at Umeed, and you have really taught your part with a lot of passion and enthusiasm. So those were the best memories of training that I have with you. And you were very, very helpful throughout the training and very much approachable. And you made my understanding about autism very, very clear, but at the same time it was not a burden. So it was a very beautiful journey which I had with you, and so today we are with this interview. So
yes, absolutely.
Yeah, so Gopika, as you also mentioned in your earlier interviews, that there is very much less which has been written by Indian authors or Indian parents on autism. I also felt the similar way when I was searching for some content to understand by myself, or at times even parents have been asking that what are the books that we should read. And there are a lot of books in therapy, but there is no warmth like that warmth is there in Beyond the Blue. So how do you feel to be this first Indian parent author who is writing on autism?
I think I feel very privileged in a sense, because I think that this sense of privilege actually has stayed with me for the last, I think once I kind of understood Ree's diagnosis and came to terms with it initially, I realized that just how privileged I was. And that was what really kind of compelled me to join, because I realized that I don't have to struggle pay for therapy. I don't have to do without a meal to pay for therapy. I have the resources in terms of financial resources. I have the connects with medical doctors to avail the best treatment possible. I could buy him whatever aids I needed, you know, in terms of teaching aids or whatever. I could afford to go to different schools, to try out different schools, to try and employ shadow teachers, occupational therapists. I basically had it very easy, and also I had a very, very supportive family, which I think makes a big difference. Not only my family, my in-laws' family, extremely supportive, very, very supportive, who just put their heart and soul into this boy. And when I kind of looked around me at Umeed, I realized just how incredibly privileged I was. That's what really kind of propelled me to join Umeed, because I felt that I have to give back. After being so privileged, there has to be some way that I have to give back to society, and I have to do something to help other kids like me. Then, of course, cut to 10 years later after Umeed, when I wrote this book, again, I realized that I was in a position where I could tell my story without any hesitation. I could tell my story without there being any sort of social repercussions, without, any kind of it backfiring in any way for me, either within my family, within society, because, again, of this, the position that I am, where I have the kind of support that I do. And that is why I felt that it was not only something which I could do, but something which I should do. And it really was very, very liberating to tell it, because I relived the whole process, you know, starting from the diagnosis, all the initial years, which I had forgotten about. You know, I would actually ask my husband, do you remember this time when this happened? What happened? I've forgotten. Mm. You know, so I relived the whole thing. And I came out with so much more appreciation for Veer and so much more love for him than when I started out. Because when I relived the whole thing and I reflected on it, I realized how far he has come and what an incredible achievement he has made, you know, to really kind of surmount the odds and come so far. We still have a long way to go, but I felt very proud of him. And it was a privilege to write this book, because I realized the impact only after it was published. I have had people who don't have children on the spectrum, some people who are not parents at all, who said that this is not only a story of how to deal with a child with special needs, but it is also a story of resilience and how to build up resilience. And for me, that is the ultimate compliment, that it can appeal to somebody who doesn't even have a child and that it can speak to them. So it has been an incredible thing.
Yes. So as you rightly said, this was, you really wanted to give back. And I'm sure that right. This thought of yours has helped, and it will keep helping a lot of people. And those parents, whoever have commented on the book, that it has helped them also in spite of them not having a child with special needs. They are perfect in their saying, because I would also agree with them that it is an overall journey of a person who is resilient and who is going through a lot of processes, and at the end, who is still thinking about giving back to the society. So it is just amazing, and I would really like to appreciate this gesture of yours. Yes, because even I can see that those parents I was mentioning, that they used to ask me that what should we read, and whenever I used to tell them that yes, whatever you are feeling is all right, or whatever you are feeling, most of the parents are going through this, there was no basis, because I am not a parent. And when some parent is writing, instead of just talking, of course, the talking and sharing also has its impact. But when it gets written, it really has therapeutic value to it. So yes. I would really like to thank you for writing this book and helping.
Thank you.
Yeah. So as you said that this happened after the diagnosis of Veer, and as you started working with Umid, you got trained. So I'm sure that while writing, and you, as you also said, that you went through that whole journey again as you were penning it down. So I'm sure that there must have been a lot that you must have revisited, that you must have thought about. So how was this journey of writing, and were there any challenges while penning it down?
I think it was very cathartic, because I could relive the emotions, and once I relived them, it was like almost like a purging of the emotions. Mm-hmm. So it was very, very, I think it helped me evolve as a person. Like I said, I think reliving the whole thing, like I said, helped me appreciate him so much more. It helped me understand him more when I, you know, because I mean, of course I was, I, you know, I'm with him every day. I work with him. I'm in his life all the time. But I think when I look back and I could relive everything, I think that really helped me appreciate him more. The challenge actually for me was where to stop, because I would sit and write. I had expected it to be over by December last year. But I finished in June 2020, because every afternoon I would sit and write during the lockdown. And I finished by June 2020. And it was every day I would write one chapter in the afternoon for about an hour, hour and a half. I would sit from 3 to 5 roughly would be my writing time. And while I was writing, I found that there was so much to say. It was almost like the words were waiting to come out. You know, and so it was difficult for me, because I didn't know where to stop. And so I remember talking to my husband and saying, this book is just becoming this huge book. I don't know how to stop it. And he said, okay, stop writing now, enough. And I said, no, but there's so much more to say. Because you see, you realize that you are trying to encapsulate, he was 15 at the time, he's 16 now. You're trying to encapsulate 15 years of your life. So where do you stop? What do you talk about? How do you stop? You know, to know where to stop was difficult because there was so much to say. And now so many people have told me, now you should write a book after 5 years about, you know, the ages from 15 to 20. I don't know if I'll be able to do that. But the thing is that that was the only challenge, I think. Otherwise, it was a very smooth process. I didn't have a problem. Those people whom I had to, you know, interview for kind of, you know, there were a few people I had to speak to for expert advice, were very cooperative, very good. I was able to, you know, really kind of capture a lot of stuff. There were a few chapters which I felt I could have added to the book. But again, that's something which I can always look at as a second edition, third edition, whatever it is, because it's a self-published book. I can always add them at any time. But I think for right now, it's just perfect the way it is.
Yes, so it will be exciting to see the second edition or the second part of the book for sure. So that's a good news, I can say, that you have shared with us.
I don't even know if I'm going to be able to write it yet. God knows. I'll have to wait and see after another 5-6 years.
Yes, but we can always be hopeful, and it's a good thing. My another question was on these lines, that are you planning to translate it in other languages of India?
So the Hindi translation is over. Okay. It is done. It is being checked as we speak. It's currently being checked. And my next step is a Marathi translation. I would also like to translate it into Gujarat. So at least these three languages are, you know, I really, really want to get the translations done. Hindi, hopefully, I was hoping to have it out for 2nd April for World Autism Awareness Day, but I don't think it'll be out by then. But I think by about June, July, it should definitely be out there. Because again, it's the same kind of formatting. We just have to kind of, you know, put the chapters into the format. So we're not redesigning a new book. We're just, you know, just reformatting it. So hopefully by June or July, the Hindi edition should be out. I do want to make the Hindi edition a lot more affordable for people. And so I would be pricing it lower, because I think that is something which needs to get to people. And I think everybody should be able to afford it. So for me, that is of prime importance. I think Marathi, hopefully I will be giving it once the Hindi is done. I will try and give the Marathi translation out, and maybe by the end of the year, if it's out, that would be a great thing. I don't know how long it will take. Again, Marathi is a language which I cannot proofread and I cannot read, so I'll have to find somebody to kind of work on that and really get the essence of the book. So that is something I'm working on. And so if not later, by the end of the year, then definitely early next year, hopefully Marathi will be out. And I'm hoping by next year sometime, Gujarati will also be out. So I would like to work on these three, because I think that if I can really help parents to get a sense of empowerment and positivity, and all parents, I think it would really.
Surely. So that is great to know that it will be getting translated in at least 3 to 4 more languages, and it will definitely it will definitely help more and more people. So my next question was, though you have already mentioned that many parents approached you and have given you feedback that it has been helping them a lot. So are there more feedbacks or opinions or anything that people shared when the book was out?
I think the one word that everybody has used, or the two words that everybody has used on the book, about the book was, it's raw. and it's honest. And people have actually told me, we cannot believe how honest you have been about your family. For me, this is something which was, I mean, it was non-negotiable. I think there is no point writing something if you cannot be true to yourself. At least that's what I believe. And so if I have been very honest about my emotions, I think there is a tendency when you have a child with special needs, any kind of special needs, and especially with autism, to kind of gloss over the whole thing. You know, that especially in India, ye bhagwan ki deen hai, you know, this child is a gift from God, special, you are a special mother, that's why you got a special child, all that. When you're in the middle of a meltdown, you don't feel like this child is a gift from God, you know. It's very, very difficult. And at that time, it's not easy to remember that you are special, and so you have been chosen to kind of parent this child. That's not the case, you know. There are too many kids out there. Mm-hmm. So at the same time, what I didn't want parents to feel was this sense of kind of gloom and doom. You know, I wanted them to feel that, yes, no matter where our child is on the spectrum, no matter what the child has in terms of skills and abilities, I can work with this child and I can teach this child. And this child has a future. Because I believe that every single child, after having worked with numerous kids, I think I must have worked with a total of 400 to 500 kids in the course of my time at UNI. Different kids, different profiles, different presentations of autism. And I don't think there is a single child who I have worked with where I feel like this child cannot learn. Because they all can learn. You know, they all can learn to do things where it makes their family life a little bit easier and makes the child's life also better. And so I think that just that feeling that, yes, my child can learn and that something positive can happen, you can make a positive step towards some sort of progress, is really what I wanted parents to feel. At the same time, I didn't want them to feel, like I said, like this unrealistic kind of, you know, religious almost kind of aura around them being special needs parents.
Yes. So it is very much realistic, though you have mentioned all the honest experiences that you have had, it is nowhere leading other parents to get into all sense of superstition or all the things that one can believe which are away from reality. So yes, that I also think is the book's speciality. So moving ahead, I know that you have written a lot of other books as well, and now this is Beyond the Blue. So what do you think of this print media in terms of spreading awareness of autism?
I think, honestly, I think that media, whatever the form, whether it's print, whether it's television, whether it's films, radio, I think that there needs to definitely be not only more awareness, more acceptance. And I think that is something which is absolutely paramount. We are in 2021. And I would say that compared to 13 years ago when Veer was diagnosed, the situation is much better now. But we have such a long way. We have a very, very long way. And I think that, honestly, this is something which only the media can do. You know, I remember talking to somebody and saying that, you know, how quickly people have learned to wear masks. Yes, it's another matter that people are not doing it right now. But how quickly people have learned to wear masks, how quickly people have learned to wash their hands, to use sanitizer. You'll notice that people everywhere may not wear a mask. They might wear it over here, but they'll go and they'll put sanitizer on their hands and clean it. Why? Because the media has helped. You know, you pick up the phone and there's a message which says, there's coronavirus, wash your hands, you know, wear a mask, whatever it is. Use sanitizer. So I think the media plays a huge role in doing that. And yes, books to help with that. Because also I think for parents, you know, when you hear another parent speak and you say that, okay, this person has done it. This person has gone on and lived their life and has kind of come out at the other end of the tunnel. I can do it too. Then you are more likely to believe that parent than you are likely to believe your therapist or your pediatrician or anybody else, just because that person has lived through it. And so I think for a book like this to happen, I think it's important. It is important because, you know, that it is my experience. And I wish that when 13 years ago, when I had got a diagnosis, everything I read was Western. Mm. You know, I just couldn't relate. So yeah, I got the understanding and the comfort that somebody else has lived through this on the other side of the world. And somebody else has kind of lived a good life and managed to do things. And that gave me a little bit of hope. But it wasn't my context. It wasn't my world. So that's why also writing this book is important.
Yes. So as you said, any kind of media or any format is good, and we have to speak more and more about it, whatever format is comfortable to us. So my next question was on these lines, that if there are any young writers or rather any writer out there who wants to write on mental health, are there any tips or suggestions that you would like to give them?
I think you just have to be honest. You just have to be true to yourself, and you have to be respectful to the people you're writing about. If you are somebody who's facing mental health, then you need to be respectful towards yourself. And if you're writing about somebody else, you need to be respectful towards them. You need to have that language of respect. Mm-hmm. And I think that is very, very important for anybody who's writing. Apart from that, I really feel that when you are honest, it really strikes a chord. And, you know, again, being completely honest and not trying to gloss over your feelings or justify your feelings is what works. So that's the only thing I would say.
Yeah, so it is very helpful to know that, yes, writing honestly is more important, because often when we start writing, we feel that, oh, I have to write rosy. I have to write in such a format that attracts
people. Yeah.
And according to what you have said, that is just going to fail. So
absolutely. Being honest
is, I think, the key. So
yes.
From the angle of publishers who would print even if we write, that question often bothers writers. So what do you think, how we can find our way through that? Because I'm not sure whether publishers are open to publish something on mental health or autism or any other condition. So what was your experience?
Right. So I have been a published author of 4 books before I wrote Beyond the Blue. And I chose to self-publish with this one. The reasons were many. One was that it was something which was very close to my heart, so I wanted more control for it. Secondly, in terms of distribution, I felt that this would have much more distribution than a traditionally printed book. Print runs in India are typically about 2,000 to 3,000 copies for non-fiction books. That too, even though I've written 4 books, I'm not what you call an established writer. So I'm not like a Shobha Day or a Amitabh Ghosh or somebody like that. And so my print runs would typically be about 2,000 to 3,000 copies, which would be distributed all over India. Now, for that to happen, it means that every time, which used to happen with my other books, was that every time somebody ordered it or was looking for it in a bookstore, it was never available. I chose to self-publish because this is something which is it's a company called Notion Press, and what they do is they print on demand. So if you order 1 copy, you will get 1 copy. If you order 10,000 copies, you'll get 10,000 copies. They'll just print according to what is ordered. And I felt that that was a far more, it was a model that was a sustainable model, because it would help me to distribute. And it would help me to have a constant supply of books that was available for people to read. So if there is a case, I will say, however, that mental health is something which is becoming a topic of interest to a lot of people, and so publishing houses might be more open to it. But having said that, if they are not, I think writers now, more than how many ever years ago, 2009 is when my first book came out. So writers now, more than in, like, say, you know, 10, 15 years ago, have the option of going the self-publishing route, and it's not considered something like it was then, which only people who didn't get published used. Now it's becoming a viable option for a lot of writers. And so I would say that if there's some, there's a story to tell, if you have something to talk about and you cannot find a traditional publisher, just go this route, because it will really help to get the word out. And the more people who write about it, the better, because then it becomes normalized and it becomes a topic of conversation that we all need to have.
Yeah, thank you so much for these words, because I'm sure this will motivate a lot of writers, because I have come across many people who have stories who are not necessarily right. from the field of mental health, but they have interned somewhere, they have given their time in volunteering, and they have a lot of stories to tell. And they often feel that they are not experts, or who will publish it, and why should they write it? So I think it will be a good message for all of them, whoever has had a good experience, honest right. experience, right. and they want to write it and reach out to people. So thank you so much for that message. Towards the end, I would like to say that the book is written mainly for parents, so they are going to definitely get a lot of help from reading the book. You have mentioned you have given advice to a lot of writers who would like to write. And as we all are aware, 2nd April is approaching, and it is World Autism Awareness Day. Instagram is going to be flooded with a lot of awareness messages, and there will be a lot of activities which are of course helpful, but overall do you have any message for today's youth about how they can be more aware, or how they can be more accepting of autism?
I think we need to stop calling it World Autism Awareness Day. I think it has mm-hmm. to become Acceptance Day. I think awareness is now, even though we need more awareness, I think more than that, what we need is acceptance. Mm-hmm. I think if I were to talk to the youth of today, I would say that people on the spectrum are so much more than their autism. And that is why the title Beyond the Blue, because blue, as you know, is the color that is associated with autism. But beyond that autism, there is a whole person out there who can be so many other things. You know, they can be kind, they're funny, they've got a good sense of humor, they can be very, very, interested in cars or dinosaurs or, whatever, Formula One racing. They are extremely talented. Most of the individuals I have spoken with or I have met, they are very loyal friends, very honest. And I would really tell people that if you do meet somebody on the spectrum, look beyond that autism, look beyond the blue, and really see what they are, and see how you can just connect with them, and create that level of acceptance within yourself and the people you meet, because that's really, really what we need. We are getting to be a point where we're in a world that is increasingly getting polarized, and if we are all going to be the same, how are we going to make room for differences? So we need to make room for differences, and we need to really accept them for what the differences are.
Mm-hmm. I really like the way you have put it, that more than awareness, more than knowing what autism is, of course we need to know what autism is, but knowing yes. what is beyond that would help us and even everyone in the society more and more, and then we can reach towards that society which is more inclusive and happier. I think I would like to stop here by telling our audience that yes, go read the book, of course, and do check other work of Gopika as well. And I would really like to announce that on Instagram also, she is having this one series where she is interacting with individuals with autism condition, and it is really a good series. So please check out her Instagram handle.
I need to correct you. It's not just individuals with autism. Yes, I have had somebody with autism, and I'm going to continue to invite people on the spectrum on the show, but it is basically anybody who's doing any work around autism. So I have had somebody who runs an art-based curriculum in Bangalore. I've had an occupational therapist. I've had somebody who does work on executive functioning, someone who's a couples counselor for neurodiverse couples. So it is all kinds of services that are centered around autism. So it's not just people on the spectrum. It's for anything to do with, and it's called Beyond the Blue Chat.
Yes. Thank you for the correction. And yes, I would like to encourage people and see that series as well, along with today's interview. So thank you so much, Gopika. Towards the end, is there something that you would like to add apart from the discussion that we have had?
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I think the more we kind of raise awareness, the more acceptance will be, and I think it will be a better world for people.
Yes, I'm sure. And we all will work towards that. And we need more and more people to guide us. We need more and more people like you who are having this professional experience, who are ready to talk honestly and guide others. So I look forward for learning more and more from you. And thank you so much for sharing your time.
Thank you.
And we'll hopefully plan more activities on around this.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.